Hi all, I'm Milena Valentini, an Alexander von Humboldt Fellow at the University Observatory of Munich. And in this talk, I'll discuss the evolution of bulges in a cosmological context and focus on their formation, kinematics, and chemical evolution. Cosmological hydrodynamical simulations are key theoretical tools to investigate the way in which galaxy bulges assemble their mass across cosmic time. These simulations indeed allow us to study the formation and evolution of galaxies hosting bulges and provide a valuable framework to interpret observations. In particular, cosmological simulations of spiral galaxies represent a powerful testbed to gain insights on the formation of galaxy bulges. Nowadays, cosmological simulations of spiral galaxies succeed at simulating systems which are dominated by the stellar disk and whose bulge order total mass ratios are in agreement with observations. However, this was not always the case, as early simulations suffered from spurious loss of energy and angular momentum by the gas component, and therefore they usually produce bulge-dominated systems. Gaining accuracy in the description of the sub-resolution physics, so of all those physical processes occurring below the resolution limit of the simulation, was crucial to overcome the limitations that I've just mentioned. Also, a proper modeling of feedback processes was extremely important, and a key role was also played by the resolution of the simulations and by the hydrodynamical solver adopted. This is the framework in which our effort fits. Indeed, I'm going to discuss the results from a suite of cosmological hydrodynamical simulations of spiral galaxies that we carried out with the Lagrangian gadget tree code. We use a sub-resolution model which describes a multi-phase interstellar medium and features several physical processes such as H2-based star formation, thermal and kinetic stellar feedback, a model for chemical evolution, and it also accounts for the presence of black holes and agent feedback. As for the initial conditions of our cosmological hydrodynamical simulations, they are zoomed in and target a Milky Way-sized halo. This halo is expected to host a spiral galaxy at redshift zero, also because it is characterized by a quite low redshift matching history. We carried out a comparative study. We implemented four different models for stellar feedback in our cosmological simulations and quantified the impact that different prescriptions adopted to model stellar winds have on final properties of simulated galaxies. Here I show the four galaxies that we have simulated, and we see maps of projected gas density. In the first model, we assume that supernovae explosions inject feedback energy within a cone that is directed towards the least resistance path. In the second model, we assume that the ISM is isotropically provided with stellar feedback energy. The third model is characterized is a stochastic thermal feedback, while the fourth model is characterized by winds with constant velocity. Here are the stellar counterparts of the four galaxies. The maps of projected stellar density allow us to appreciate how the numerical prescriptions adopted to generate galactic outflows and to model stellar feedback are the main shaping factor of the stellar morphology at low redshift. Indeed, we see that different galaxies are characterized by a different morphology and have different properties. We can quantify the impact of different stellar feedback models on galaxy morphology by analyzing the distribution of the stellar mass as a function of the circularity of the stellar orbit. To analyze the circularity of the stellar orbit, we exploit this ratio of specific angular momenta, which allows us to perform a kinematic decomposition of the stars in the simulated galaxies. So we are able to distinguish between the stellar mass, which is located in the bulge and the stellar mass, which is located in the disk. We see that the bulge over total mass ratios of the simulated galaxies depend strongly on the model adopted to describe stellar feedback, and also that the stellar mass in the galaxy bulge is highly sensitive to the model adopted to describe stellar winds. In the simulations that I've discussed so far, we only included stellar feedback in order to better isolate the impact of numerical prescriptions used to model supernova explosions. We can repeat the same analysis also on simulations which are more complete, as they include also the impact of agent feedback and of early feedback. Here with early feedback, I refer to explosions by hypernovae that occur in an almost pristine ISM, so in a metal poor interstellar medium. We see that including early stellar feedback has a strong impact on the stellar mass of the galaxy bulge. And this impact is even more important than the effect of the black hole feedback. All these flavors of feedback have a strong impact on the star formation history of simulated galaxies. Here, we consider the star formation rates as a function of the redshift. And we see how, for instance, the high redshift star formation burst is dependent on whether the early stellar feedback is included or not. To gain further insight on the formation of galaxy bulge, we can analyze the distribution of stellar ages in simulated galaxies. And here we see that high redshift star formation occurs first in the innermost regions of the forming galaxy, and then soon after, halo stars originate. The oldest stars spread across the halo and in the galaxy bulge, and they can be as old as 12 gigayears. Then, as time passes, star formation mainly interests the innermost regions of the forming galaxies, as they are replenished with gas accreted from the large scale, and only at later epochs the galaxy disk forms and its formation proceeds inside out. Of course, the details of the distribution of stellar ages is dependent on the adopted feedback model, but the results that I've just outlined are general. Cosmological simulations are also useful to investigate the metal content of stars in simulated galaxies. For instance, here we focus on the stellar enhancement in alpha elements with respect to the solar ratio, and we compare predictions from the simulations, so the background to the histogram, with observations of stars in our own Milky Way. We see that the agreement between the two is remarkable, and we can also exploit the ratio of specific angular momenta that I've just discussed to tell apart the contribution from stars of the galaxy bulge from that of the galaxy disk. We see that if we focus on high values of iron over hydrogen, stars in the galaxy disk are characterized on average by lower alpha enhancement with respect to stars in the galaxy bulge. And this result is consistent with the picture according to which the galaxy bulge formed over shorter timescales and is mainly affected by early feedback of massive stars alone. Simulations are also important to quantify the impact that different components entering the chemical evolution model have on final results. Here, for instance, we show how changing the assumed initial mass function or the sets of adopted stellar yields can impact on the chemical pattern of simulated stars on this plane. And of course, it can produce a mismatch with observations. We can also analyze the impact of different IMF and stellar yields by analyzing the metallicity gradients of young stars in our simulated galaxies and compare these predictions with observations of stars in the Milky Way. Here we analyze iron and oxygen metallicity profiles for young stars, and each color refers to a different model. First of all, we see that the slopes of gradients in our simulations are in agreement with observations, and this stems from the ability of our sub-resolution model to take into account star formation and stellar feedback. This means that we are able to properly describe the process of chemical evolution at different distances from the galaxy center. As for the normalization of these gradients, we see that in order to match observations in our own galaxy, a more top-heavy IMF has to be preferred. As for the comparison between predictions from cosmological simulations and observations, state-of-the-art cosmological hydrodynamical simulations usually have stellar particles whose mass ranges between 10 to the 4 and 10 to the 8 solar masses according to resolution. On the other hand, observations in our galaxy and in nearby galaxies resolve individual stars. So when comparing predictions from simulations with observation, the common approach is to assume that the metallicity of the star particle statistically reproduces the metal content of the simple stellar population that it samples. To make a step further and to perform a comparison between predictions from simulations and observations, which is as accurate as possible, we developed a new technique. And within this approach, we can populate stellar particles with mock stars according to the physical properties that star particles inherit from the parent cosmological simulations. In this way, for instance, we are able to produce the color magnitude diagram for stars which are located within the simulated solar neighborhood of a simulated galaxy. In the last part of the talk, I'm going to explore the connection between the formation of the galaxy bulge and the central black hole growth. Indeed, there is observational evidence that the properties of the central black hole in local spiral galaxies correlate with properties of the galaxy bulge. But there is no sign of correlation between black hole properties and the galaxy disk properties. So we decided to test different prescriptions for gas accretion to the black hole and study whether it is possible to explain this presence or lack of correlations between properties of the central black hole and of the structural components of the galaxy. We see the evolution of the black hole mass as a function of the redshift for three different models. In the reference model, we assume that the black hole can accrete both hot and cold gas. On the other hand, if the black hole only accretes cold gas, we see that it experiences a faster growth at low redshift. The third model considers an angular momentum dependent gas accretion. So we basically suppress the accretion of gas with high angular momentum since it is supported by rotation velocity and therefore it is prevented from being directly accreted onto the central black hole. We see that according to this model, the black hole mass grows until redshift 2 because of gas accretion, but then it does not accrete gas anymore and it can only increase its mass if a merger with another black hole occurs. And this picture is able to explain the correlation between the black hole and the galaxy bulge as the black hole increases its mass during the bulge formation phase, while it does not increase its mass anymore at later epochs when the galaxy disk forms. Now, to conclude, we have seen how cosmological simulations suggest that galaxy bulges form at high redshift and assemble their mass through a few bars of star formation. The prominence of the galaxy bulge in late-type galaxies is highly dependent on the models assumed to or on the model assumed for stellar feedback. And also we have seen that including early stellar feedback is extremely important to suppress star formation at high redshift within the galaxy bulge. As for the evolution of galactic bulges, we have seen how the stellar enhancement in alpha elements show that the bulge formed over shorter timescales with respect to the disk, and also that the inclusion of an angular momentum dependent gas accretion to the black hole can explain the correlations between black hole properties and bulge properties in late-type galaxies. Thanks a lot, and if you have questions, please drop me an email.